Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, everybody. Thank you, Lord, and everybody ought to praise the Lord. It's good to be back in the house of the Lord one more time. I can truly say down from the inside, hallelujah, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. And I don't know about you, but I entered into his gates with thanksgiving, and I came into his porch with praise. Thank you, Lord, and it's a good thing to be able to thank and praise the Lord. Come on, give God a praise. Hallelujah, he dwells in the midst of praise. Thank you, Lord. How many of you got to press your way through the storm, through the rain? Amen. Sometimes you got to press your way through sickness. Amen. And through pain. Amen. You can depend on God. God is a dependable God. And I thank God that we can depend on him. The Bible says it is of the Lord's mercies that we are not consumed. Because his compassions, they fail not. They are new every morning. Great is the faithfulness of God. How many of you are glad for God's faithfulness? Amen. Pastor Duck got stuck on God's mercy. Thank you, Lord. She said, God's mercy just endures forever. It'll never run out. Amen. How many of you are glad about the mercy of God? Hallelujah. That it endures forever. These things ought to be the things that we think about. Amen. Hallelujah. These things ought to be the things that we praise God for. His character and his attributes, his power and his glory. Hallelujah. Don't sweat the small stuff like the brother was saying. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Don't miss the forest because of the trees. Amen. Hallelujah. Look beyond the pain. Look beyond what you're going through and see the hand of God operating in your life. Amen? Hallelujah. When I look back and wonder, thank you, Lord, how I got over, I want to say it was God that has been good to me. Amen? Thank you, Lord. And we praise God for all that he is and that all he is doing. Truly, without the Lord on our side, there's no telling where we would be. Amen? Thank you, Lord. I'm serious about God. Are you serious about God? Thank you, Lord. I thank God for your seriousness. Thank you, Jesus, because when you're serious with God, you've got your mind made up and you've got your heart fixed. Yeah, you'll be able to see the handiwork of God. You'll be able to experience the power of God. Thank you, Lord, if you keep your mind staying on him. He said, I'll keep you in perfect peace if you keep your mind staying on him. And I just want to encourage you to come on out and encourage other people for our mortgage burning ceremony. Amen. On March 11th. Amen. Hallelujah. Come with your best praise. Come with your best shout. Amen. Come with thanksgiving and with joy. Amen. We're going to have the a.m. service. Then we're going to have dinner. Then we're going to have the 4 p.m. service. Amen. Preached by none other than Bishop Ronald Mathis. Amen. So let us prepare ourselves and let us come. Invite your family and your friends. Amen. And look and pray for a glorious time. Amen. A week before, we're going to go on some fasting and praying so that we'll be able to see the hand of God. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. So I want you to stand with me on today. Hallelujah. And I want you to turn with me, yes, Ephesians chapter 4, verses 1 through 3. If you haven't, say amen. Amen. Amen.
I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you that you should walk worthy of the vocation wherewith you are called, with all lowliness and meekness, with long suffering, forbearing one another in love. Endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, even as ye are called in one hope of your call.
Yes.
One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in you all.
Amen. Amen. You might as well read verse 7 and finish the thought.
But unto every one of us is given grace according to the measure of the gift of Christ.
Oh, gracious Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord, we just say thank you.
Thank you.
We thank you for this word on today. Lord, we ask you, Lord, that you gather my mind and gather my thoughts. Hallelujah. Let it become your mind and your thoughts. Lead us and guide us, Lord, under the power of your anointing. And Father, we'll thank you and praise you. Bless the souls that are here to receive with meekness the engrafted word of God to the saving of our souls. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. And I just want to literally take for a thought this morning from Ephesians chapter number 4 and that verse, particularly verse number 1. And Paul is saying, I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you that ye walk worthy of the vocation wherewith ye are called. Amen. And I just want to take a thought this morning. Amen. Answer the call. Answer the call. And in this particular chapter, Paul is writing to the Ephesians church to encourage them. Amen. Because they were going to encounter some great things in their walk with the Lord. And chapter that's coming up, he's going to tell them also to put the whole armor of God that they may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. And when you realize that God has a particular calling on your life and realize that God has created you uniquely special, that the hand of God being involved with you is a tremendous thing that you don't want to let go. Amen. If there's anything that I love about God, is his involvement in my life. If there's anything you want to love about God, is his involvement in your life. That God cares about you. So Paul says, I therefore the prisoner of God. He said, I beseech you, I beg you, amen, that you walk worthy of this vocation wherewith God has called you. You see, the Bible says in the book of Hebrews that in sundry times and in diverse manners, God had spoken unto us, unto the fathers by the prophet. But in these last days, he has spoken unto us by his Son. Amen. Whom he had literally made heir of all things, who being the brightness of God's glory, who being the express image of his person, when Jesus literally had by himself purged our sins, the scripture says that he literally sat down at the right hand of God with the expectation that all of the enemies become his footstools. And when we begin to understand the life of Jesus Christ, we understand that even from his birth, Jesus was always about his Father's business. Jesus was always about preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God. In fact, Jesus' first message was, repent ye, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. The kingdom of heaven is nigh thee, even in thy mouth. Jesus was serious and on point about his preaching unto you to repent, to turn, hallelujah, because the kingdom is of heaven is at hand. And this would bring very significant into the hearers that were there at Jesus' day, because God, between the book of Malachi and the book of Matthew, there rested literally 400 years of silence where God didn't speak to anybody. They just had the books of the prophets. But Jesus Christ, when he came on the scene, he was announced by John the Baptist. Y'all remember remember John the Baptist? He came out of the wilderness and he was preaching, "Repent ye, hallelujah, for the kingdom of heaven is hand." And when the people started to respond to the preaching of John the Baptist, hallelujah, they came repenting. And he said to them, "Oh, you generation of vipers, who have warned you to flee from the wrath to come." Now, hallelujah, and as John was preaching, he then saw Jesus in the distant, far away, coming unto him to the river of Jordan to be baptized of him. And John recognized and said, "Lord, I'm not worthy to be baptized. Hallelujah, to baptize you. I'm not worthy to unloose your shoes." Hallelujah, but Jesus said, "Let it become of us to fulfill all righteousness." So he baptized Jesus. And then the Bible says that the heavens opened. Y'all remember the story? That the heavens opened and the Spirit of God, it descended upon him in the form of a dove. And then God himself testified. He testified from heaven. And he said, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased." He said, "In him I'm well pleased. In him I am well pleased." And then the Bible says that the Spirit of God, it drove Jesus to the wilderness. And he fasted 40 days. And how many nights? And 40 nights. And then the Bible says he was tempted of the devil. And he was so caught up with the mission. He was so caught up with his experience that the Bible says he was afterward a hunger. Have you ever been so consumed with God that you forgot even to eat? Have you ever been so consumed with God that you allow things to slip because you were so attracted by the power and the favor of God? I hear the writer say, "As the deer panteth after the water brook, so panteth my soul after thee, O God." I hear Job saying, "Lord, so things are too high for me. I desire you more than my necessary food." There's something special about God. There's something special about in the presence of God. There's something about being near the lover of your soul. There's something special about calling on the name of Jesus. The name of the Lord is a strong tower, and the righteous runneth in, and they are safe. And Jesus was so consumed about getting himself ready for his call. He was so consumed about getting himself ready that the Bible says that afterwards he was a hungered. And when the enemy came to tempt him and said, "If thou be the Son of God," the devil wants to steal your sonship. The devil wants to make you doubt who you are and whose you are. When you realize that you've been bought with a price, when you realize that you are not your own, you are a dangerous person. You are a dangerous somebody. Because you can then say like Paul, "If I live, I still live. If I die, I still live." So in any case, it's a win-win situation. Tell your neighbor, "I'm in a win-win situation. I'm in a win-win situation." So Jesus, he begins to preach and go about the cities of Galilee, telling the people to repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. And Jesus began to publish the gospel of your salvation. How many of you know that gospel? The gospel is the power.
salvation to the Jew first and then to the Gentile. The words that Jesus preached, he preached with power. The words that Jesus preached, he preached with authority. I remember a day when Jesus, he came into the synagogue on the Sabbath day, and he opened the book to the book of Isaiah, and he found it in the book of Isaiah, where he read in their hearing that the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, for he hath anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He hath sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captive, and the recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty them that are bruised, to preach the acceptable year of the Lord. And when he had finished, the Bible said he had closed the book, and then he began to sit down, and he said unto them that this day this word has been fulfilled in your hearing. Whom the scriptures had said that should come had entered into your presence, and he came in preaching this gospel, the gospel of Jesus Christ, which is the power of God unto salvation, unto God. You can be delivered. If you believe the gospel, you can be set free. For whom the Son set free. You just tell your neighbor is free indeed. Whom the Son is free. Whom the Son is set free. Is free indeed. I hear the writer say that unto us a child is born. That unto us a son is given. And the government shall be upon his shoulders. And his name shall be called show. you free. He wanted to free your mind from the captivity of the enemy. He wanted to free your body from the slavery of sin and death. Oh, I feel this thing up in here. Oh, so many wonderful things about Jesus. Oh, yes. So God had a purpose. That's why the Bible says that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are the called according to his purpose. And a lot of people get that confused. They think that applies to them if they're not in the kingdom. They think that that scripture applies to them if they're not in the body of Christ. But I stop by to tell you today to set the record straight. If you're not born again of the water and of the Spirit, that scripture does not belong to you. It only belongs to them who have been to the water, who have been baptized, who have repented for their sins, and have been filled with the precious gift of the Holy Ghost. You want to give God a praise. You want to give God a praise. But when you realize, hallelujah, that God, he foreknew you, those that would come and accept the invitation of the gospel of Jesus Christ, he foreknew you. And then the Bible says that he predestinated you to become conformed to the image of his Son. And whom he foreknew, he predestinated. And them he predestinated, them he called. And those that he called, he justified you. He washed you in the blood of Jesus. He cleansed your filthy mind. He justified you. He washed away your sin. What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. And what can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood. Tell your neighbor, nothing but the blood. Nothing but the blood. The blood still works. The blood will cleanse you. The blood will purify you. The blood. Save you. The blood will take you through in operation. The blood will take you through the valley of the shadow of death. Tell your neighbor, the blood still works. The blood still works. The blood still works. So he said, you see your calling, brother. Not many noble, not many wise are called. When you heard the gospel of your salvation. And that's why Paul says, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you walk worthy of the vocation wherewith you've been called. Tell your brother, I gotta walk worthy. I gotta walk worthy. I gotta walk worthy. I gotta walk worthy. You see this invitation. When he said vocation, he was referring to the call of the gospel of Jesus Christ. When you heard this call, when you heard the call, God was saying, come unto me, all ye that labor and heavy laden, and I will give you rest through Jesus Christ. He said, take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. He was saying, come, come without money, come without price, and receive this calling of salvation. You see, a lot of us, we know that God has a purpose and a plan. Oh my God in heaven, I feel like like preaching up in here. You know God has a plan for you. You've been bought with a price. And the only way for you to actualize the plan of God for your life, you have to accept the gospel of Jesus Christ. You've got to accept the call. You've got to accept the invitation for you to be washed, for you to be cleansed, for you to be set free. He said, "What worthy of that calling to actualize your purpose?" When you accept the calling of God, you actually are accepting the purpose that God has for your life. A lot of us are confused. We try to do things our way. But how many of you know there is a way that seems right to a man, but the end of that way is death? But last time I looked, it was God that said the steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord. If you want to make your path straight, you've got to come to the Lord. If you want God to bless you exceedingly and abundantly, you've got to let go of your life and pick up the life that Jesus has set for you. Come on and give God a praise. The gospel is his invitation. The gospel is his invitation.
Yes, sir.
He's inviting you to come. He's inviting you to all taste and see that the Lord is good. He's saying, "All taste and see that the Lord is good." If you want to fulfill your purpose, you've got to take heed to the call. Hallelujah. The Bible says, thank you, Lord. Make your calling and election sure. Hallelujah. Jesus, he was encountered by Peter, James, and John. They were fishing. Jesus said, "Drop your net and follow me, and I'll make you fishers of men." And the Bible clearly says that these were ignorant and unlearned men. But because they answered the call, they turned the world upside down. And people to know that they had been with Jesus.
Yes, sir.
Tell your neighbor, answer the call. Answer the call if you want to work out your purpose. I'm reminded of a man by the name of Paul up from Tarsus, who had letters going to Damascus to slay the saints. But one day Jesus appeared unto him. Hallelujah, said, "Saul, Saul, it's hard for thee to kick against the pricks." And he said, "Who art thou, Jesus?" And he said, "I'm Jesus, whom thou persecutest." Answer the call. And when Paul answered the call, hallelujah, he was filled with the Holy Ghost. He was filled with power. Hallelujah. God said that he's a chosen vessel unto me, and I might show him the things that he must suffer for my name's sake. And Paul answered the call. He said, "I'm forgetting those things that are behind me." Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He said, "I'm forgetting those things that are behind me. Because I've answered the call, I'm reaching forward. The things that are before me," he said, "I'm pressing toward the mark of the prize of the high calling of God, which is in Christ Jesus." Hallelujah. You've got to answer the call. If you want peace in your life, you've got to walk worthy of that vocation. You've got to walk worthy of the calling for which you were called. That's what he was saying. Walk worthy of the vocation for which you were called. That word vocation means calling.
Yes.
You gotta walk worthy of the calling for which you were called. He didn't call you to be a victim. He called you to be a victor. So you got to answer the call. Answer the call. Answer the call. Live such a way that people know you're answering the call. Live such a way that people know that you accepted the gospel of Jesus Christ. Live such a way that the power of God just radiates off of you, that yokes are being destroyed, that every burden is being broken down because you answered the call.
Thank you,
Lord. Jesus. Shanda. Hallelujah. You answered the call. Hallelujah. You must answer the call to reap the benefits. If God has called you to be a pastor, answer the call. If God has called you to be a minister, answer the call. If God has called you to be an usher, answer the call. If God has called you to be a helper in the church, answer the call. And walk worthy of that vocation. In other words, magnify your office. Oh, y'all need to be shouting right now.
Pastor, I'm getting there.
Hallelujah. Then some of you should have said, Pastor, I'm ready right now. Answering the call. Hallelujah. Answering the call. Let the church stand. This invitation is final and unchangeable. God, for an unchangeable purpose that God has for your life. Yes, Lord, God has a purpose for you. And if you're going to achieve the purpose, you have to drop your net and follow Him. A lot of people think that, well, Lord, I want to be an artist. I want to be a doctor. I want to be a lawyer. The key is that, Lord, what would you have me to be? Because God preordained you. Which means he knew you before you knew yourself. And he predetermined the time which you should come into this world. He worked it out that you should be a resident of Erie, Pennsylvania. He worked it out that you should be here to hear this word on this particular day. That's why Jesus said, come unto me. If there is one here today that is struggling with their purpose, if you want to be